my talk is mitigation and control of animal diseases. So I have been working in this area for the last 10 years. Next slide. So this is the brief overview of my today's talk. So I have summarized it into 5 points. The first one is the impact of animal diseases, and then the roots of disease transmission, and what are the daily practices adopted by the farmers to control the diseases that is known as farm biosecurity. So this practice is mostly adopted by the commercial farmers. So, and what are the practices through which we can control the disease at a state level, national level? And what are the such activities that we are doing in Nifty to control the diseases? Next. So as you know that the animal diseases, they can impact animal health, human health, as well as the economy of the country. So in animals, they cause death, illnesses, as well as the reduced fertility. When there's no fertility, no production. So less milk and meat production, as you are all aware. And in human beings, so it causes zoonosis. Zoonoses are those diseases that are transferable between human beings and other animals. And these type of diseases, zoonotic diseases, they cause stress and fear in the general public. As you know that in case of Congo fever, so nobody, I think most of the people, they are reluctant to go to the cattle markets to avoid that disease. And in case of economics, these diseases, they are major barrier, major obstacle in the trade. So, and also there is a, these diseases, they lower the consumer confidence. In case of, you have seen in case of bird flu, because they hesitate to eat poultry, consume poultry. And also the people, they avoid to go to the animal markets and different dairy farms. So during the last 2 decades, the world has seen epidemics of different veterinary diseases, like FMD, that's foot and mouth disease, and there are also different diseases that belong to animals. And I would like to mention that more than 60% of the animal pathogens, more than 60% of the human diseases, they come from the animals. So, so the previous presenters, they have told different animal pathogens that have been used in bioterror. So animal pathogens, they are the potential bioterrorist agents because they can affect animals as well as the human beings. So in case of nowadays, the people, they are working on a one health concept, one health approach to control the diseases. So one health approach is that involving, that is the integrated effort at national or international level by different agencies to improve the animal health and human health as well as the environment. Because these three parameters, they are interconnected. So these three parameters, if we address all these three parameters, then we can control the disease very easily. So we, in order to control the disease, we should address all three parameters at the same time. Next, please. So roots. Roots of transmission, animal diseases, they are transferred from animal to animal as well as human to animal to human as well as human to animals. So through different routes, like oral, aerosol, direct contact, fomites, these are the non-biological agents like ropes, different equipments, and vector-borne, like in case of Congo fever. The ticks, they are the major source of the disease. So in case of aerosol, we like diseases like bird flu, foot and mouth disease, they spread through aerosol. Only 10 to 12 particles, there are enough to produce a disease. And the disease animal sheds around about millions of particles on daily basis. Next, please. So these are the practices that are adopted by the dairy farmers to control the disease. I will quickly go through this because this is not much relevant to the to this seminar. So there are to the farmers, they follow these guidelines to avoid the entry of the pathogens in the farm. They restrict the entry of animals, human beings, as well as traffic. So you should display these signs on the entry of your dairy farm that don't enter without permission, because then people like truck drivers or different medical reps, they enter without permission. So they are the main source of the introduction of disease. So only allow those people with appointments and the people you know. And there is should be a visitor log as well as. So the other thing is that the people, they don't care about the roaming cats and wild animals there, because they are also the reservoir for different diseases. They move from farm to farm and they cause disease, like wild cats, the dogs. So in case of traffic, so there should be a disinfected dip. Dip means you should apply disinfectants at the doorstep of a uniform to different types of trucks, and so that they can be disinfected. And there are different vehicles for on-farm and off-farm use. Next, please. So quarantine is very important in disease control. So before introducing an animal into the dairy farm, so that animal should be isolated for a certain period of time, about 40 days, so that if any disease is present, it will emerge. So in the meantime, you should also conduct different type of tests of different diseases so that we can diagnose the disease. And you should keep the water and feed clean and examine, because feed is also a source of mycotoxins and different types of bacteria like E. coli, Salmonella. So always use a protective clothing. So this is very important because it will protect the worker as well, and also plays an important role in disease control. So you should also provide this in the form. Next, please. So at the last, so you should have health records of every animal, because you should, if you have the health record, you can determine their health status as well as the effectiveness of vaccines and different things. So, and there should be the trained personnel in the dairy farm, because they can, if the trained person is there, so he or she can easily detect different signs of disease and immediately report to the veterinarian, different people, higher-ups. So isolation of the disease animals is very important, because in case of viral diseases, there is no specific therapy. There's no specific antibiotic. So in this case, isolation is very important to minimize the spread of the disease. And the farmer should adopt the regular vaccination programs. So livestock department has devised certain vaccination plans. So farmers should adopt these plans. And the timely treatment is very important, because if you treat that the animal at an early stage, you can minimize the spread of the disease as well as you can, and there are more chances of recovering in the early stages. So now I will come to the main point, that's the disease control at the national level. So these are also the guidelines by the international body, that is World Organization for Animal Health, Office International Epizooties. So this is the main international body that is dealing with the diseases at international level. So it has many member states. So that the member states, they reported the disease to this organization, and this organization then deal with that disease at international level, provide funding and provide different experts and different type of funds to control the disease. So according to these guidelines, and these are also the recommendations for the disease control. If we want to control the disease, so you should follow this. This is the ideal recommendations. So first one is the establishing rationale. Then strategic goal and objectives. So I will discuss each in next slides. So establishing rationale. So every country should state the proper rationale of controlling the disease. So what is the justification of the control of the disease at international level? So for this purpose, your rationale should be based on 3 points, like disease situation. So you should know the level or the prevalence or the incidence of a disease in a country. So, and then disease impact on human beings as well as animals, as well as biodiversity, as well as on different stakeholders, like for example veterinarians, businessmen, farmers. And you should also involve stakeholders in this case, because the stakeholders are the one who implement your research findings, and who can, if you engage these stakeholders, then they can easily understand your research findings, and it is easier to implement the control of the disease. Next, please. So goals and objectives. So you should define goals and objectives rightly from the outset. So ideally, eradication of disease is the goal of every control program, disease control program, but it is not always achievable. for example, those diseases that have reservoir hosts, like those diseases that have that involve vectors, so they are difficult to control. If we vaccinate all the animals in the, on the earth, then it's even then difficult to control, because the reservoir hosts, like mosquitoes, different vectors, they are difficult to control. So in this case, mitigation of the health impacts is important. So we can reduce the their effects at a certain level, control level, so that this level is okay. So while defining the goals and objectives, you should focus on the these 4 points: biological factors that involve in the disease spread, availability of the technical tools, control measures, as well as the socioeconomic considerations. So all these are interlinked. So we should address all these in order to control the disease. So biological factors, for example, certain diseases only affect certain species of livestock. For example, foot and mouth disease only affect the large animals like dairy animals, and it has nothing to do with the horses and dog and cats. So you should also consider what type of disease you are targeting and what type of disease you are controlling. So some diseases and other cases that genetic stability. Some viruses, bacteria, they are genetically instable. For example, they are prone to different mutations. They adapt rapidly to the environmental changes. For example, in case of foot and mouth disease, in case of bird flu, avian influenza. So you can see different strains after every 10 years, 15 years, different strains emerge, different nucleotide sequence. I think 5-10 years back, there is a change in the Newcastle disease, that is of poultry. So even our vaccines, they fail to control. So wildlife never survive is also very important. For example, in case of rabies spread through, in case of bats, chamgadar. So bats are the main reservoir. In case of influenza, migratory birds, they are the main reservoir. You can control. So some viruses, they are very, so most of the viruses, they survive in their host, but some viruses, they survive for a longer period of time in the surroundings, like in the soil, in the water. Like foot and mouth disease, virus can survive for 10 to 12 weeks on the bedding, on the clothes. So this is very important, availability of the technical tools. You should have appropriate diagnostic tools. So as mentioned by Sayyid Javed Khurshid, that if you have a rapid on-site test, so they will help you to identify the disease at early stage. They help to warn us at the early stage. So in order to control the disease, so these tests, point of care tests are very important. And we in NIPGI, we have different point of care tests like lamp-based assays. We can easily apply on the fields and then can detect the disease within an hour. Instead of sending a sample to the national laboratories and different things, it takes weeks to get the report. In the meanwhile, the animal expires. So we should have these tests so that the local veterinarians, they can, although the local veterinarians, they are very expert in diagnosing the disease, but some diseases are very difficult to diagnose on the basis of signs and symptoms. So vaccine is very important. So the main problem in our country is that we are importing the vaccines. So they are the foreign bacteria, foreign viruses. And our circulating viruses, they are different. So although they produce immunity, but not to that extent, which our bacteria can produce. So there is a need to develop our local vaccine industry. But there are very few high quality vaccine labs in the country. And I, according to my viewpoint, that Veterinary Research Institute Lahore is producing certain vaccines, and these are just conventional vaccines. So these are certain control measures. So I have told control measures like movement control, stepping out. If, for example, in the UK, there was a huge epidemic of foot and mouth disease, and they killed all the livestock in the area. So this is another method to control the disease. So I think due to the lack of time, in this case. That's socioeconomic considerations. So your program should be cost effective and feasible, so that the farmers, they can afford. So because the farmers are a poor community, so we should devise that plan so that they can afford. And if we are culling the animal, we should provide proper incentives and packages to the farmer. Otherwise, the farmer will not cooperate with you. And there is a, that's the last point is very important, that is a political will. And there should be a political support as well, like from support from government to implement these guidelines. So for program planning, so everyone should cooperate. So the main, it is the main responsibility of the National Veterinary Laboratory, Veterinary Authority, to implement this program in cooperation with the stakeholders and as well as different dairy farmers. So there should be a campaign at national level, as well as there is a sustainable funding. Funding is very important. Next, please. So implementation plan, so it should be implemented through a regulatory framework. There should be a veterinary legislation for this purpose. So OIE, that is the World Organization for Animal Health, this has, it has certain veterinary legislations for the control of diseases. So the disease surveillance is the pinpoint, underpinning point that can be used. That's the main point that can be used for the disease control. So we should follow this. So first of all, disease reporting is very important. So I'm also a veterinarian, and most of our fellow veterinarians, they don't report the disease. And then the disease spread to a mass level, and then they know that disease is present, because it is the task of every veterinarian to vaccinate the people, to vaccinate the animals. So if the disease is present, it means that it shows the poor efficiency of the veterinarian. So why the disease is present? He's using vaccine and still disease is present. So proper mechanism of reporting should be there. Next, please. And the vaccination. So, Sayyid Javesh Mushi sir asked me to put more emphasis on vaccination. So, role of vaccination is very important. So, there should be a widespread vaccination campaigns. That should be free of cost to the farmers. And there should be also be the tests that can detect their efficacy. For example, after a certain period of time, you can check the antibody titer. So, if the antibody is producing at the optimal level or not. And there should be, I think, the high quality vaccine labs for animals. For vaccine quality, so I even told you that there should we should prepare the vaccine from the local isolates. So that vaccine should be more effective. And vaccine delivery, most of the people, they don't know the, and we should also maintain the cold chain, because due to the electricity problem in veterinary sector, we don't have refrigerator in every hospital. So if the temperature of the vaccine is 4 to 8 degrees centigrade, so the people, they store the vaccine at 37, 45 degrees centigrade. So this is just only water, not a vaccine. So at the end, we should have sufficient vaccine bank. Adequate vaccine as well as sufficient quantity of vaccine, so that we can, in case of emergency, in case of epidemic, we can use it at mass level to control the disease. And for case, in case of transportable animal diseases like avian influenza, different other diseases, so there should be a regional cooperation with the neighboring countries. So no country can control these diseases alone. So and there should be a participation from the stakeholders. And the important thing is that you should educate your farmers regarding this. So outbreak investigation. In case of outbreak, what we will do? So we will collect the sample. We will go to the area, and then go to the area and perform certain observations. So if the disease is present, then we collect the samples and perform different tests. If the test is positive, and then we perform the DNA sequencing, perform phylogenetic analysis, and in this case, through this methodology, we can do similarity searches. So our virus or our bacteria is similar to this, the bacteria of India, bacteria of Afghanistan. So through this technology, we can easily trace back the origin of that agent. Whether it is an epidemic or whether it is a terrorism. Next, please. So emergency preparedness. So you should have a proper plan in place in case of any outbreak. So you should test. You should test it on regular basis, so that all the people, they know their responsibility and there should be a proper command and control for this purpose. And in case of outbreak, there should be a proper containment of the area, and nobody will allow to go to that area without any work or any. And there should be a proper compensation packages for the farmers, so that the farmers, they are not discouraged in this case. So monitoring and evaluation is very important. So after going through all these activities, you should identify. So it is your duty to identify the gaps. So what are the gaps, and then you fill up these gaps in your next plan and adopt in as objectives. Next, please. So at the end, I will briefly discuss you about the such activities at NIPG. So NIPG is the pioneer lab in the country that has developed the PCR-based test for animal diseases. So we participated in the Rinderpest control program. So up till now, two diseases have been eradicated from this world, that is smallpox and Rinderpest. And we participated in the Rinderpest eradication program at the national lab in the country. So we are performing molecular-based tests for FMD, PPR. These are diseases of different animals. And nowadays, we are working on developing the point-of-care tests for different diseases so that veterinarians, they can easily detect the diseases and we can control the diseases right from the outset. So training of the field veterinarians, this is our annual activity. We do this activity on 1 week training to the, we provide this training to different veterinarians, different students throughout the country so that they know the diseases and different control measures. So that's all about my presentation.
Thank you, Bill.